Good afternoon, people. Good evening, good evening. Good evening. Facebook. Buddy, we can hear you down up here, buddy. Everett. Hey, cousin, I'm about to go live right now.
Bye.
All right. Hey, everybody. I think y'all can hear me. Let's set this. You might have to go tell them. Otherwise, he's going to get kicked off that game. Turn break. Shh. Checking connection. Uh-oh. Hey, what's going on, IG? What's going on, Facebook? Are y'all there? Hey, what's going on, Dale? I see you. Hey, what's going on, Patricia Neslin? What's up, sis? Let me play this music. Hey, what's going on, Charmaine? What an evening, y'all. What an evening. What a time, y'all, right? What a time. Y'all hear this song? Hey, Tisha, what's up, classmate? What's up, cuz? Crystal? Unhethylene? Hey, beautiful. And this song is called War Cry by Queen Naji. Just gonna sit here and meditate on it, y'all. Say, we gotta fight, y'all. Not physically. Thank y'all for joining. What's going on, Oscar? What's up, my brother? What's up, my brother? Much love, man. Much love to my people, man. Thank y'all for joining me, man. I almost didn't do this tonight. But not everybody who tunes in is in Houston. Yeah. What a time, y'all. Yes, I love that song, right? What's up, Jeremiah? What's up, cuz? Speak some knowledge, huh? God's truth, brother. God's truth, man. At a time such as this. And like I said, I with Blackout Tuesday, I almost wasn't here, but I could have gone down and protested, but I wouldn't have had as much impact as I may have right here with hundreds of thousands of people, you know. What's going on, Chris Starch, my brothers? What's up, Cleveland? Tony? Man, this is a beautiful thing. Hey, cuz. What's up, Gonzo? I missed the gym, brother. I missed the gym. War Cry, y'all, by Queen Naji. We got to do better, man. We got to do better, yeah. Got to stay focused. You're right. God is calling us for such a time as this. This is no coincidence, y'all. It's 400 years of this, y'all. It's time for us to do something different. We have been oppressed for 400 years. It's time for the oppressor to change his heart, because this thing going to get tore down if he doesn't. So we're going to talk about that tonight. It's all biblical. It's like we the Israelites. And Pharaoh need to free his people. Need to change his heart, soften his heart, man. Or we're going to tear this whole thing down. God going to destroy this whole thing. This is a war cry. Not a physical war cry, y'all, because violence ain't going to do it. That's not going to solve any of our problems, y'all. but I'm going to pray, y'all. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this gathering, Father. Thank you for this opportunity to share your word with my people, with your people, Father, with your children, Father. Thank the children for showing up today, Father. Such a time as this, Father. We need it, Father. We need you, Father. We need your hope, Father. We need to see your face, Father. We need to see your works, Father. We need you to step in and change the hardened hearts of these wicked people, Father. Change their hearts, Father. Let them know that they can't possibly be your people, Father, if they haven't seen you, Father, but hate their brothers that they see every day, Father. It's not possible, Father. They're on the other team, Father. Let them know that, Father, so they can have a change of heart, Father. There's no way, Father. There's no darkness in you, Father. You're all holy, Father. You are the light, Father. You are the salt of the world, Father. We are the light, Father. We are the salt of the world, Father. We are the preservers of the world, Father. Let us preserve this place. Let us be a light to one another. Let us love one another properly. Let us love one another like you love the church, like you love us, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your word, Father. Thank you for your power. Thank you for your might, Father. Thank you for covering us, Father. Thank you for a time such as this, Father. Thank you for allowing us to live, Father, to be the people that make a change, Father. We are the people we've been waiting on, Father. We are those people, Father. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for these people showing up, Father. I want to bless and put a prayer out there for everyone who's lost loved ones, Father, for the family of George Floyd, Father, for the horrific thing we witnessed, Father. I'd ask you to remove the wickedness out of the hearts and the hatred out of the hearts of the people who witnessed that, Father, out of the children, out of the grown people, Father, of all races, Father. Remove that darkness out of us, Father. We need you, Father. We need your help, Father. We need you to soften our hearts, Father. We need your love, Father. I pray for those families of those who have been slaughtered in this country, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Man, thank y'all for joining me. Thank y'all for joining me. Man, what a time, man. What a time. I'm looking outside right now, y'all. I see the moon is showing up. The moon and the sun out. The greater light and the lesser light, y'all. And we need to be both of them, y'all. Sometimes we need to be the sun, and sometimes we need to be the moon, right? Because our light shines the brightest in the darkest places. So we need to always be a light. We need to always move in love. We need to always be willing to help one another, Father. We need to all want to be the good Samaritan. You know, we need to all understand that everybody is our brothers and sisters, because we are all your children. We're all your children. And we all need help, Father. And we need your presence right now, Father, in such this time. Man, this is a wicked time, but I'm just thankful to be here, to be black, not to say anything against any other races, but I'm just thankful. I'm thankful, Father. Like I said, I'm thankful for everyone who showed up and attended tonight. And this lesson is really coined as America Must Repent. America Must Repent. When we sin as individuals, you know, he tell you that, you know, his mercies are renewed. His mercies and graces are renewed every day. So we go to our safe spaces, our quiet places. We walk off into our wilderness places and we repent for our sins. We confess our sins and we repent for our sins, Father. And you say, you forgive us. Our slates are wiped clean. And that's what we need America to do. We need America to, first of all, acknowledge their sin and repent for that sin and move forward, Father. Thank you. Hey, what's going on, Shantae? So like I said, tonight's topic is America Must Repent. And, you know, I remember the first time I actually did this, I went live. We talked about the 400 years of slavery, and it's just so relevant. It was just on my spirit. It was so much on my spirit then, and it's so much on my spirit now, how 2019 represented 400 years of slavery and this Exodus moment, and I believe this is our Exodus moment. And I say, exit us. It's time for us to do something different. It's time for us to leave this space. I don't think it's a little bit late for us to go back to our country, but I definitely think it's time for us to have a new renewing of the mind, a renewing of the spirit, a renewing of the soul, a renewing of our flesh, a renewing of our works. It is definitely time for, we're going to get to it for some economic and spiritual reformation, right? Most importantly, I think the spiritual reformation will bring about everything. It's because one thing I think about too, I think about Judaism and I think about the Old Testament and what happened in the Old Testament. and how the Jewish people move in this country today and how they're prosperous because they're simply practicing the things that were taught in the Old Testament. And I just want to put a call out there to our people to, like I said, pick up that book, man. That book is powerful. The Bible, Basic Instructions Before Leaving Earth. It will bless you. It will bless. I don't know a person who picked up that book, who read that book, who's gone through that book, who did not receive, who wasn't blessed. Now, so many books. Look, I have a bookshelf full of books over here. I done read so many of those books that really didn't bless me. But it's one book that can bless all people. It's the Bible. Pick it up. Pick it up. It saved my life. And I say it'll save a wretch like my life. It could save anybody's life. It changed Paul's disposition. It convicted David. God's word does all of that. It does all of that. And we all need to be convicted. You know, we all need to have a sense of our spirit to show up to let us know we're going right and wrong. You think about it, in the Old Testament, there wasn't a, they didn't have the Holy Spirit. So God sent these different prophets to be like a conscience to people. He would just stand in the middle of the city and say, God told me to tell y'all this. God told me to tell y'all this. Jeremiah and Ezekiel and Jonah and all these different people and Elijah, Isaiah. They always say, God came to me last night and he told me to tell these people this. But right now we have the Holy Spirit. We don't have to have prophets. We have the Holy Spirit that will convict us, that will tell us, son, don't do that, baby, don't do that. Don't go left, go right. We need to listen to it. But in order for us to be more and more in touch, more and more in touch with our Holy Spirit, we must read God's word, because more and more we feed his spirit, the more and more, God, Instagram went down on me, y'all. The more and more we, gosh, let me go back on, y'all. Let's go. Let's say that. I'm sorry, y'all. But yeah, the more and more we have his spirit, we feed his spirit, the more and more his spirit will lead us. The more and more. Go back live real quick. Okay, I said that. Oh, Lord. Instagram. It's technology. I'm sorry. But see, the devil be working, y'all. He be working. He's busy all the time. He's busy all the time. I just want to go on live. He won't even let me go on live, y'all. Make it plain, bro. Yeah, exactly. I'm going to keep it plain, Patrice. But yeah, the more and more we go into the spirit and feed our spirit, the more and more God actually will guide us. Our Holy Spirit will guide us. We don't need prophets. We only need to listen to our spirit, and which is God in us, the God in us. Exactly. Meditate daily. We start our days off, like I said, I go in there, I read the Bible. We go in there, I meditate in the dark. I used to go in there butt naked in my closet. I would just go in there naked in my closet and just surrender myself to God every day. And just start off with prayer, start off with repenting, confessing my sins, repenting, praying, studying his word, and just meditating there in the dark, man. Just meditating there in the dark. Trying to get this Facebook back on, y'all. I mean, Instagram. But yeah, just meditate there in the dark. And so we got to do better, man. We got to do better. I just hate, you know, just to see what happened last week was just horrific. I've never seen anything like that in my life. For me to witness something like that in a movie would have bothered my spirit, would have bothered my soul, y'all. So we, like I said, we just got to do better. And tonight's topic is America must repent. America must repent. And we were talking about how, like I said, about the first time we actually went into this, the first time I actually went live, man, I can't hate. Give me a second, y'all. I hate the fact that this Instagram, I got people all over that's tuning in. Okay, here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Go live. Go live. See, the devil be busy. He wicked. Like I told you, the devil wicked. Hey, Instagram, I think I'm back live. But, you know, he's always busy. Like I say, Satan is always busy, y'all. And the more and more you have a powerful message or you have something to convey, the closer and closer you get to God. Said new levels bring about new devils. You know what I mean? New levels bring about new devils. And as you rise, the walls are going to be there. But we have to push forward. And God say his word is a lamp to our pathway and light to our feet. So we must push forward, y'all. Follows that you started video live. Okay. But anyway, I have to just move forward. But so we must move forward, y'all. We must move in that direction. And like I was telling you, like the first time I actually talked, had a on live Kingdom Culture session, we talked about slavery. We talked about the 400 years and the reconciliation and how, you know, our lives, the 400 years of slavery here in this country, and what happened in the Exodus. But then, you know, I was thinking about, and like I said, today I thought about going out there and really protesting and not, possibly not coming on live with Blackout Tuesday. But one thing I really thought about was, you know, I can go out there and protest and do that. That'd be great. But I think this is way more important because actually more people, I have a bigger impact on people here. So I'm here, y'all. And I thank y'all for joining me. But like I said, you think about this 400 years, we are living the lives of the Israelites. We're in such a broken system, and there's so many parallelisms between what we're going through now and what the Israelites went through. And so that's what we're going to talk about tonight, y'all. It's just, I don't know about the state of emergency of this country, but one thing I do know is that America must confess their sins and America must repent, y'all. And so we can move forward. So we can move forward together in brotherly love, in harmony. We can be a unified church, a unified body, a unified people. And so tonight I wanted to talk about a couple of things because the same God that rescued the Israelites from Egypt, the same God that sent his begotten son for us is the same God who's trying to rescue us. It's the same God. And we think about the fact that some people, when President Trump took over in office and people were like, man, I hate that. And I just kind of sat back. I'm like, you know what? I know what, regardless of what the devil does or what happened, God has to allow it. So if God has to allow it, we know it's 828. It's all happening for the good. So ultimately, I believe that Trump is in office so that, and like I said, I don't get into politics, but one thing I know for sure, regardless of what political party you're part of, is that Trump has brought a level of transparency to this country that I believe that's much needed. Because even the people that's on the sidelines, even if you weren't an advocate for equal rights, advocate for the black justice and empowerment, man, you watching that, you have to be heartless, not to be moved by what you've seen and witnessed in America in 2020. You have to be heartless to not be moved and bothered by what you actually witnessed happen to my brother, George Floyd, last week. You have to be heartless. And so you think about all that. And so he allowed all this to happen, y'all. And I just believe that something good is going to come out of this. I know that violence isn't the route. We need to have peaceful protests. And we need to understand the history of how we got here. We need to understand the history of why oppressive people oppress people. The reason that oppressive people is because of fear and insecurity. Fear and insecurity. Right? Fear of losing what they have, or insecurity of they might not be worthy. This population of people may be more powerful or whatever. And that was true 3,000 years ago. That's so true today. You know? And so today I would just beg that everybody in here just, you know, not just aspire to try to make a living, but we need to, each and every person needs to aspire to make a difference. We need to aspire to make a difference, a contribution in this world. When Jesus came, he said, I didn't come to be served. I came to serve. And we're trying to be Christians, people that are seeking our salvation. We should be trying to be Christ-like. And I'm talking about Christ-like in all ways, everywhere we go. Meaning we're forgiving. We're being bold and courageous. We're living in faith and not fear. Because it said, do not fear is in the Bible, like I say, 365 times. So we know fear is not a component. Fear is not something that Jesus advocates for. Only time he's in the Bible, he really recommends fear. He says, fear God. Fear, he said, the fear of God is the beginning of knowledge, beginning of wisdom. So the thing about it is fear, I would have to associate that with Satan when we say fear. And so when I think about why oppressive people oppress people, it's out of fear. I'm saying these oppressive people are most definitely minions, workers of Satan. Just like we are God's hands and feet and we are God's mouthpiece, these oppressive people are Satan's mouthpiece. These oppressive people are his hands and feet. These are the people that you know, that does the recruitment for him. You know, they're the advocates for his ways and his wickedness. We need to be the advocates for God's light, for God's love, for God's unity. I don't care what race, what creed, what nationality, what Democratic Party, what professional football teams, basketball teams, man, you my people, everybody is our brothers and sisters. So anyway, I was thinking about this message, and like I said, I was thinking about a couple different things, and God gave me a message, y'all, and I said, wow. I said, okay. So today I wanted to take you all to Exodus 1. So we want to go to Exodus 1. This is before the rise of Moses. This is before actually Moses even moved into in Egypt in the Pharaoh's kingdom. This is after, right after Joseph, just a little context. Joseph, if you guys don't know about Joseph, Joseph was one of the sons of Jacob, which is, he's the father of the 12 tribes of Israel and God. And Jacob was the guy who actually fought with God and God wrestled with God and God broke his hip. And God, because of his determination, he said, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. And God ended up changing his name to Israel. And all of his 12 sons became the 12 tribes of Israel. And Joseph was one of those sons who his brother sold him off into slavery. And then he went through prison and did all these things. And eventually he ended up being the second man in charge in Egypt, in a foreign land. And then back in Israel, there was a famine. You know, it was a drought coming. And it happened so that the person who saved the people from Israel in Israel from the drought happened to be Joseph. And when Joseph reunited with his brothers who actually sold him off into slavery, you know, they was like, oh, forgive us. And then Joseph was wise enough to realize, he said, you know what? God meant that for good. God sent me into slavery. He put me through all that so I can be here at such a time as this. Because if I wasn't here with Pharaoh, if I wasn't here in Egypt and had gained favor, you guys would probably perish and would die, a whole population of people. But because they did not die, because he actually was in Egypt, because ultimately his brother sold him years and years ago, he ended up getting to Egypt because of God had favor for him and God had a plan for his life in spite of what it looks like. He ended up saving a whole population of people. So the way that the Israelites got into Egypt, they initially came. They didn't come as slaves. They came as people with favor because David asked Pharaoh if he could bring his family. He can bring his people because he had favor. Joseph asked Pharaoh and Joseph was the second in charge. And when they came over, it was 70 of them. So that's a little context. So here in Exodus 1, it's talking about the Israelites moving into Egypt. This is before Exodus, right? This is Exodus 1. So we're going to go to Exodus 1, and we're going to read the entire Exodus 1. Yeah, I'm going to read that to you. I hope y'all are listening, right? It says, Exodus 1 says, now these are the names of the son of Israel, the sons of Jacob, who came to Egypt with Jacob. They came each with his own household. Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, Benjamin, Dan, Naphtali, Gad, Asher. All the persons who came from the loins of Jacob, all the persons who Jacob birthed were 70 in number, right? But Joseph was already in Egypt. So this is saying, this is all Jacob's sons who came over. Remember, it was only 70 of them. By the time Exodus came, 400 years, y'all know, it was almost 3,000 of them. 3 million of them. So they came in as 70. 70 Israelites went into Egypt. I think about the slaves that came here. It was only like 200 slaves that initially came here. You know, it was only like 200 slaves. Now it's like 44 million. We represent 13% of the population in America. So 200 slaves came to America. 44 million blacks in America today, y'all. So think about that. 70 Israelites went to Egypt, came into Egypt. 3 million left Egypt 400 years later, right? So here we go. We're going to pick up on, in Exodus 6. Exodus 1, 6. And it says, so Joseph died and all his brothers and all the generations, but the sons of Israel were fruitful and increased greatly and multiplied and became exceedingly mighty. Take that in consideration. You think about the slaves multiplying and becoming mighty. Because guess what? We are doing the work. We built this country. We're out there laboring. We are the struggle. When I say struggle, build muscle. That's why genetically there's something to it. Because we are the workers. We did this physically. So it says here in Exodus 1, it says the Israelites were fruitful and increased greatly and multiplied and became exceedingly mighty. So that the land was filled with them. So Egypt became filled with these Israelites. Now, a new king arose over Egypt. And like I told you, Joseph had a favor with the previous Pharaoh because they all was like Pharaoh this and Pharaoh that. So he had favor with the initial Pharaoh, but now a new Pharaoh came in. He had a totally different disposition. And so he said, now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, behold, the people of the sons of Israel are more and mightier than we. They are more and mightier than we. So the Egyptians were looking like, man, these people are more and mightier, more of them, and they stronger. And hey, fear. That's right. Fear, right? That's when the fear sets in. Oh, we got to do something. How can we keep these people oppressed? Right. And so then he says, come, let us deal wisely with them. Let us put together a systematic oppression system. Let us put them into slavery. Let us keep them down. Let us hinder their lives. Let us murder them. Let us kill them. Let us hang them. Let us castrate them. Right. He said, let us deal with them wisely with them, or else they will multiply. And in the event of war, they will also join themselves with those who hate us and fight against us and depart from the land. Right. So they're trying to keep you down because they say, hey, if you grow too much, if we take our knee off your neck, you might get too much sense. You might gain too much education. You might grow as a people. You might unify the population. So we have to keep y'all like Babel. We have to keep you confused because the devil is the father of confusion. He want to keep you confused because if you're working on one true accord, hey, something good might happen and we might lose our power and you guys might treat us like we treat y'all. And we can't allow that to happen in Egypt or in America. We can't allow that to happen. Because if y'all get it together, hey, man, y'all are power. He said, y'all are mightier than we. Come on, man. Come on. He said, so they appointed taskmasters over them to afflict them with hard labor. They appointed taskmasters over them to afflict them with hard labor. Y'all heard that? So our generation don't know much about that, but our ancestors knows a lot about being afflicted with hard labor. Like I said, we built this country. They assigned it. This was systematic oppression. Systematic. We came over here as nothing but slaves. That was the only intent, was for us to be slaves, y'all. That's it. No one at the time could see beyond that. No one could see that. We were just slaves. We were a property. We were an asset. Right? That's it. They didn't think that one day we would have equal rights. And some of them still have the same mentality. Some of our oppressors still have the same mentality. And then it says, and they built for Pharaoh storages. We built cities, right? Pithoms, Ramses. We built cities. We built this country. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and the more they spread out. The more they afflicted them, the more they grew and became powerful and resilient and rose, and still we rise. So that they were in dread of the sons of Israel. So they were scared of Israel. They say, man, the more they afflicted them, the more powerful they became. So the Egyptians compelled the sons of Israel to labor rigorously. And they made their lives bitter with hard labor in mortar and bricks and cotton. You know what I mean? In cotton and work and labor. All kinds of labor in the field, all their labors which were rigorously imposed on them, all the labor in the field that their ancestors did, that our ancestors did. Man, the parallel between is when I thought about it, like, oh my God, right? This is us. So rigorously, that's what happened. It says, then the king of Egypt spoke to the Hebrew midwives. He said, okay, we got a plan for them. He spoke to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shaphra and the other whose name was Pua. And he said, hey, he told him, hey, when you are helping them upon their birth stool, if it's a son, then you should put him to death. But if it's a daughter, then she shall live. So he said, hey, you know what? He told one Egyptian lady, hey, when they're having kids, if it's a son, just do something and kill him. Make sure he don't live, right? But if it's a girl, let him live, right? You know, oppress more so the black man than the black woman. She okay, but not necessarily the black man in this country that we built in the fields, period. And so he said, but the midwives fear God. These midwives are like, hey, I hear what you're saying, but my love for the Lord, hey, it's beyond what you're talking about. as an oppressor. So they said they feared God and did not do as the king of Egypt had commanded them, but let the boys live. So they let the boys live for a while, right? He says, so the king of Egypt called the midwives and said to them, why have you done these things? And let the boys live. You know what the midwives told him? We almost done with this chapter, y'all. He says, told Pharaoh, he said, because the Hebrew women are not as the Egyptian women. Say, hey, these Hebrew women not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before midwives can get to them. He said, these women not like us. These women vigorous. These women are strong. You know what I'm saying? Probably strong from all that labor, all that work, right? Because struggle be a muscle. He said, these women are strong. So God was good to the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very mighty. Because the midwives feared God, he established households for them. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, saying, every son, he put a decree out after that. He said, okay, I got to put a law. I put a law out there. He put a decree out there and said, every son who is born, you are to cast into the Nile River, and every daughter you are to let live, y'all. Amen. And that's what happened. So he said, every son you are to cast into the Nile River. And that's exactly how Moses got casted into the Nile River after the 3 months his mama tried to hide him. And he was cast into the Nile River, and the Pharaoh's daughter found him and basically adopted him and took him as one of her own. But listen to that story. Did y'all hear that? That is a parallel to why the oppressors oppress. That's why they put the knee on the neck. Because if we get in any level of control, systematic control, if the roles reversed, they're afraid. The oppressor is afraid, whoever that oppressor is, right? That oppressor is afraid that we may do to them what they do to us. And so we have to understand that's why the oppressor oppresses, because of fear. It's because of an insecurity. It's because of a wickedness in their heart, and they can't help it. I just want to pray for those people that they have a change of heart, because they are literally the devil's minions. They are the devil's minions. And the thing about it is, we think about this Exodus, and at the end of this, we got to continue to move forward and not look back. Not look back. And then I thought about a couple other scriptures, y'all, I was thinking about. Thought about Jeremiah, and God was like, look, and Jeremiah was talking to, he was talking to Judah at this time, but what God told Jeremiah was like, look, you need to communicate this to these people. And so Jeremiah, he did that. Now he has something, let me see, Jeremiah 22, y'all, Jeremiah 22, that was Exodus 1, but Jeremiah 22 said, this is what God tell these oppressors. He was talking to some oppressive people. So if there's some oppressors just eavesdropping, I want them to hear this message. He said, this is Jeremiah 22:3. He said, thus says the Lord, do justice and righteousness, and deliver the one who has been robbed from the power of the oppressor. He said, deliver them. Also, do not mistreat or do violence to the stranger or to the orphan or to the widow. And do not shed innocent blood in this place. And when he said to the stranger, to the orphan or the widow, those at that time represented the most oppressive people in the country at the time. Those population of people represented oppressed people. And so when Jesus come in the New Testament, he said, I came for the oppressed people. He said, I came for those orphans and widows, or I came for those slaves, or I came for this population of people, the people that are oppressed the most. It's just like, as a pastor, check this out, as a pastor, as a teacher, as a police officer, as a political figure in this country, if you do not have the disposition that Jesus had when he came, you need to be in a different profession. Because Jesus was concerned about the most oppressed people. If you're a teacher and not concerned about the least of them, if you're a politician and not concerned about the least of them, if you're a pastor and not concerned about the least of the people, the least of our brothers and sisters, if you're a political figure, come on. This is what's going on in this country. These people are in the positions of power and authority and have no concern for the most oppressed people. Period. That's the problem. They have the wrong heart. They need to be in a different profession. They're looking for material gains, but their heart is not in the right place. Like I say, if you're a teacher, a pastor, if you are a political figure, If you're a police officer, you need to do something different if your heart not right, y'all. If your heart isn't right, you need to do something different, y'all. So we're going to beg that this tragedy that's going on right now really checks and looks at and pierces the heart of these wicked people, you know, of these oppressive people, of these people that's living in fear. Tell them to come over and cross over to the line and get to know a God where you don't have to fear. Get to know a God that tells us to be bold and courageous. Get to know a God that says fear not 365 times in his word, in his Bible, to make sure that you know that he is God, and not to fear not in your own strength and might, but fear not because you know he got you. He has gone before you like he's gone before the Israelites, like he's gone before all these people, like he went before Joseph went off into slavery. He had already made a way for Joseph. And Joseph, he said, Joseph, you're going to serve a bigger purpose. You're going to free your people. You're going to get your people to Egypt. And so you think about that. You think about that. So I'm like, it's so much information in here. So I'm going to continue with Jeremiah, because it says he's concerned about the orphans and the widows. He said, do not shed innocent blood in this place. For if you men will indeed perform this thing, then the kings will enter the gates of the house sitting in David's place. Right. And so he's saying, if you do these things, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to bless you. He says, you can sit in David's place on thrones, riding in chariots, on horses. He said, I'm going to bless you if you have a righteous heart. Even the king himself and his servants and his people. I'm going to bless you if you have a righteous heart and do my work. But if you will not obey my words, he said, I swear by myself. You know, I said, I swear to God. God say, I swear by myself. That's what he said in his word. He said, but if you will not obey these words, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that the house will become a desolation. That this city will get tore up. All the cities in this country will be tore up if you don't get it together. That the house will be a desolation. For thus said the Lord concerning the house of Judah. You are like Gilead to me, like the summit in Lebanon. You most assuredly, I will make you like a wilderness. He said, I'll make you like a wilderness if you continue to be wicked. Like the cities which are not inhabited. You will be sparse. For I will set apart destroyers against you, each with his weapons, and they will cut down your cedars, your choicest cedars, your best places. Many nations will pass by this city, and they will say to one another, why has the Lord done thus to this great city? Why did the Lord do that to America? What happened to America? This is what the rest of these 200 and some countries will be saying to us, y'all, if we don't get it together. It said, Then they will answer, because they forsook the covenant of the Lord, their God, and bowed down to other gods and served them. Because they didn't follow the commandments. They started worshiping other gods like money, power, greed. They bowed down to those gods. Because like I said, whatever you think about the most, if you think about anything more than what you think about God, that's called idolism. Whatever it is, if it's your wife, if it's your money, if it's your job, if it's your sports, if it's your future, whatever you think about more than God is called idolism. And that's a sin, y'all. And it said, do not weep for the dead or mourn for him, but weep continually for the one who goes away, for he will never return or see his native land. And that was Jeremiah 3-10. Then I just want to read 13. It says, woe to him who builds his house without righteousness, and his upper rooms without justice, who uses his neighbor's services without pay. who uses neighbor's labor without pay. Woe to him. Ultimately, because the story ain't over, y'all. The story ain't over. You know, and does not give him his wages. Free labor. He said, woe to him. Woe to him. Woe to him, y'all. This is that's powerful. This is powerful. So my theme today, the point of this message today is America must repent. And the word repent means to feel or express sincere regret or remorse about one's wrongdoing or sin. Let me repeat that. This is what repent. When we go into our closet and before we pray, we should repent. And when we repent, this is what repent means. To feel or express sincere regret or remorse about one's wrongdoing or sin. You hear that? The word was sincere regret. So we're going to say, Father, forgive me because I did this, and then go out and do it again. right? But America needs to repent sincerely. You need to not try to sweep it under the rug, not try to say, we don't want to talk about that. That was the past, right? Because you don't know anything about that. But you know, it's easy for them, for the oppressors to say that because they haven't endured it in the things that we've been passed down in our bloodline. The things that's been passed down, y'all know the things that's been passed down in our bloodlines. You know, it's easy for someone who doesn't have that to say that. But they have to repent. America systemically has to repent because there's a population of people who can really make some changes in this world if they had a change of heart. So with that said, I said America must repent. America must repent. And I thought about another one of the prophets. He was a man. He was a non-compliant prophet. Jonah. Let me see here. Jonah in my book. Jeremiah, Jonah, and the prophets. Here we go. Jonah 3. Jonah. Yeah, so the other prophet, Jonah, he was a non-compliant prophet. Jesus told him, God told him to go to Nineveh with this message. And he had his own plans. Jonah's like, man, those are some wicked people. Those wicked people, I know it's a big city and all that. I'm not worried about those people. I got my own plans. I don't care about them. But God said, look, do my work, man. Do my work. And then Jonah, he tried to go to Tarshish. Jonah, you know, he ended up trying to go to the furthest place from where God told him to go. And so he ended up, catching a ship with these guys. And we was in a ship with these guys and it was a storm. And the guy's like, man, what is going on? Who in this and did something to their God? And Jonah's like, I did. And they was like, what? He was like, yeah, I forsook my God. My God told me to do something. They was like, I tell you what. You know, he was like, man, y'all gonna have to throw me over. To make a long story short, they threw Jonah over. And this is the story of Jonah in the well, where Jonah stood. He was in the mouth of the well for 3 days. Then the well spit him out at his destination. This is that story. But anyway, once Jonah finally makes it to Nineveh, because he didn't want to go, Jonah had a message. And Jonah didn't anticipate this happening. But this is what America needs to do right now. This is the scripture for America right now. And it is actually Jonah 3. Yeah, Jonah 3. So we're going to read Jonah 3. It said, now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, because he was not going to say he was non-compliant. He didn't want to do what God told him to do. And he's saying, arise and go to Nineveh, the great city, to this great country of America, and proclaim to it the proclamation which I am going to tell you. So Jonah rose and went to Nineveh, finally, Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now, Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, just like America is an exceedingly great country, right? We are an exceedingly great country, but we were foul. Nineveh was foul. And Jonah knew they were foul. And Jonah was like, I don't care about those people. I ain't going down to hell to the shore with those people. God, like, do my work. Do my work. Listen to what I tell you. I got my own plan. Just do what I tell you to do. And he said, that's the thing, too, I thought about. It says, now Nineveh was exceedingly great. It was so great that God was going to destroy it, right? America's so great. America, like, we're the greatest. Yeah, we're the great. Nineveh was great as well. But God was like, I'm going to destroy this place in 40 days. So he said, it was exceedingly great. It said a 3 days walk. I mean, you could walk around the entire Nineveh in 3 days. It says, then Jonah began to go through the city a 1 day's walk. And he cried out and said, yet 40 days and Nineveh will be overthrown. He said, 40 days and y'all going to be destroyed. He just going around with a PA system. Hey, 40 days, y'all going to be destroyed. Then the people of Nineveh believed in God. They like, what? For whatever reason, they believed in God. And they called a fast. Y'all heard that? They called a fast, right? And put on a sackcloth, because that's what they did. They would put ashes on themselves and they would change their clothes and put on like a burlap clothing to kind of just turn themselves down to just fast, not to be shiny, not to be boastful, but be very humble. So they would always put on these sackcloths, like a potato sack, right? These sackcloths, from the greatest of them to the least of them. It said from the greatest of them to the least of them. So everybody, the entire population, right? The greatest of them to the least of them did this. It says, when the word reached the king of Nineveh, he arose from his throne, laid aside his robe. Can y'all imagine Trump laying aside his robe? Can y'all imagine him taking off his toupee and changing suit and humbling himself? This is what this king did. This king humbled himself. He said, when the word reached the king said, I'm part of this. I'm going to do whatever it takes. I'm going to humble myself. He said he took off his robe. He took off his $5,000, $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 suit and put on a potato sack, put on a burlap clothing. And it says, when the word reached the king of Nineveh, he arose from the throne and laid aside his robe from him and covered himself in sackcloth and sat on the ashes, because ashes was another thing they would put on themselves to humble themselves. He issued a proclamation. He issued a proclamation to his whole city. And he said, in Nineveh, by decree of the king and his nobles, do not let a man, a beast, a herd, a flock taste a thing. He said, not just man, don't feed your dogs. Don't feed your herds. Don't feed your flocks. He was that serious about it. This is what their leadership did in Nineveh, because it was a wicked place which God was going to destroy, right? This is what their leadership did in repentance for the population that they used to be. Imagine our President Trump doing that, right? Imagine that. Imagine that. It says, they said, do not eat or drink a thing. Do not eat or drink a thing. So they couldn't eat or drink water or anything. It said both man and beast must be covered with sackcloth. They even put sackcloth on their animals. It was that serious. Everybody was praying and fasting. And let man call on God earnestly, that each man may turn from his wicked way and from the violence which is in his hands. Let's read that again. He said, do not let them eat or drink water, both man and beast, be covered with sackcloth, and let men call on God earnestly, that each person may turn from his wicked ways. Because it's a systematic oppression, but the systematic have individual minions, and it has to start at the minion level in order for it to graduate to the systematic level. So everybody have to check they self. Each and every one of us, we want change in our life, we have to check ourselves. You know, in order for us to all move in one direction, you can't move on my light. I can't move on your light. You have to have the light within you, and we go together and we create a greater light, y'all. That's really what it is. It said, God earnestly, each man turn from his wicked ways, which is hands. Who knows? God, and the king said, who knows? God may turn and relent and withdraw his burning anger so that we will not perish. And then it says, when God saw their deeds, that they had turned from their wicked ways, then God relented from concerning the calamity which he had declared he would bring, but bring upon them, and he did not do it. So when he seen their ways, he seen the fact that they actually repented, he did not bring the calamity into their lives that he had planned for them. So today I would just pray and hope that America would repent as Nineveh, repent as the leadership, as the king of Nineveh had a corporate prayer, a corporate fasting, a citywide, a nationwide fasting and praying of the people to repent, and God reconciled that population. He said he was going to destroy it in 40 days, and he changed his mind, right? He already knew what was going to happen. He just needed Jonah to be obedient to what he was allowing to happen. And so you think about that. That is the message. America must repent. You think about that. And I'm like, okay, I think about people out there protesting, people doing their thing. And just say America does repent. Just say President Trump, or for some reason, something, God has a move of heart, and the population of the oppressors repents and say, hey, you know, we're going to get this thing right. Because it's not just us. It's black people, brown people. It's all kinds of people in this country being oppressed. All types of people being oppressed. All different nationalities oppressed from the same systematic oppression that's been in place since the Boston Tea Party. The same oppression is still in place. These same people are fighting. They feel like they're fighting for their rights to stay in power because they're in fear of the fact that if someone else gets control, gets the remote control to the country, they're in trouble. Insecurities, fear. Because think about it, that's why Pharaoh did what he did. But my question is, what now? What are we going to do? What are you going to do? What are we going to do? Just say if we have equal rights, equal justice, because that's only the population. Because you think about it, when you think about Exodus, eventually Pharaoh let his people go. Eventually they were free. They were free. And when they was free, they were still so conditioned. They kept looking back. I'm like, well, maybe it wasn't that bad. Let me, you know. So what are we going to do different? So my question is, I think about the fact that a couple suggestions for me, this is just was on my spirit, and it's, I seen it a couple places. And like I say, it's a spiritual reformation, economic empowerment for people. I mean, those are the kind of things we need to really be focused on. We need to be focused on a spiritual reformation, y'all. We need to be focused on getting closer to God at an individual level. Like the king of Nineveh said, do it individually, and we're going to come together corporately, and we're going to pray and fast. So each and every person needs to build a stronger relationship with God, with Christ, intimately, so that we can have power in numbers. Because if we're all rolling on the same boat, we're all rolling on the same car, we have to humble ourselves and pray. If we're all going in the same direction, and I'm staying in my word every day, and I'm trying to live a sanctified, trying to really focus on my sanctification and my holiness and my Christ-likeness, and my homeboy that's riding with me is going a totally opposite direction, and we in the same car. You know what I mean? It's not the same movement. So we need to make sure that we align with like-minded people. We want to make sure that, you know, as godly people, we can't get advice from everybody, because everybody's not at the same level mentally, spiritually. Everybody's heart isn't the same, right? People's in different dispositions. So we got to think about that. We need spiritual and economic empowerment. You know, I think that you think about it, you know, financial literacy, we need some major reform, because even after the Israelites were let free, they still struggled. Their faith was still small. Even after all the miracles God has showed us, even after all the miracles that God has showed each and every one of us, out of all of that, y'all, we got to believe. It don't take nobody to give me that sermon or anything, because I've seen him work in my life that nobody can tell me any different. And you guys have to get to know him individually so y'all can see him work in you guys' life. And you're going to be convicted. You're going to be brainwashed. Like, I'm brainwashed. You know what I mean? I don't care. I'm brainwashed about it. Because the thing about the black population of people is that we got dollars. We got dollars. We got dollars. But now we need the sense. We need the sense. We need the wisdom. Like I said, wisdom is a principal thing. That's Proverbs 4:7. So seek wisdom. And while you're getting that wisdom, get you some understanding. So we got the money. We got so much money. We have, let me see. I even had the statistics. So the black, here we go right here. So this is it. So as say a year or so ago, we represented about $1 trillion in this country. The African-American population, we represent about $1 trillion in this country. There's like 226 nations in the world. Something like that, 220-some nations. Out of 226 nations with $1 trillion in revenue, you know what? We would be ranked probably the 8th, 9th, or 10th nation out of 226 nations. Just as a population of people, not as a country, just a population of black people. That's how much money we make in this country. We make more money than 220 some other countries of people. We make more money than the whole country of, let's say, Italy is one of those countries. We make more money as a population. So like I said, we got money. We got money. We make money. But now we just need to make sense. We need the sense to go with that money, which is good. So my thing is, and then the thing too, I thought about, like I was watching some earlier, this brother made a good point. He said, you know, we get so happy by spending money. Oh, I'm going to get this check so I can go buy that. We get this check so I can go buy that. I can't wait till I get this money, so I'm going to go buy me these new shoes. I'm going to go buy these guns, whatever. I'm going to go buy this. But the thing about it is, we need to have that same excitement when we think about investing and saving our money. We need to think, have that same excitement, that same zeal when we think about invested in our people, invested in creating opportunities, because we have a lineage of people. We have a lineage of kids that's following us. We have a lineage of people who you know, looking up to us, that's going to come behind us. We have great grandkids that's going to feed off of us, y'all. You said, we don't, even the thing is, like I said, we make so much money in this country. We don't necessarily need more resources. We just need a better direction for those resources. Because like I tell you, the new levels and different things, it's out there for us. It is out there for us, y'all. It is out there for us. I hope somebody was really just inspired by this message, y'all. I hope it motivated somebody to do something different. I hope it motivated somebody to do something different with their future, with their money, with their finances. Y'all, you can play the music for me. Yeah, I just hope it inspires some people to repent, to have a change of heart, y'all. And this song here, I'm going to have to get out of here. Y'all know we went a little long today. Thank y'all. Thank y'all, man. God is awesome. Repent and change our lives, y'all. Repent. Repent, y'all. This is sad. This is sad, y'all. This is sad. But we can be brand new. America needs to be brand new. America needs to repent. America needs to repent like Nineveh. And we need to understand why oppressive people oppress. Oppressive people oppress because of fear and insecurity. That's it. And fear is not a God. You know, fear. God says fear not, like I say, 365 times. Matthew 5:14 said, you are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Be that light. He said, I'm not going to light you up to put you on a basket over you. He said, I'm going to light you up to put you on a lampstand so you can give light to everybody in the house. Give light to everybody around you. Your light should be so radiant that you impact the people in your life. You impact the people at your job. You impact the people in your community. You impact the people in your city. Be a light. You impact your kids. You impact your kids' kids. That's how bright your light should be. Be a light, y'all. Love y'all, Father. In Jesus' name we pray, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for this opportunity, Father. Thank you for making each and every one of us brand new today, Father. All we have to do is repent, Father, and ask for your forgiveness, Father, with a fervent heart, Father, with a righteous heart, Father. Thank you, Father, for cleansing our sins, Father. Thank you for sending your Son, Father, the Lamb, Father, to cleanse us, Father, Emmanuel. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Father. Thank you for this opportunity, Father. Thank you for this message today, Father. Thank you, Father. We want to pray for those families. We want to pray for those cities, Father. We want to pray for those people out there riding, those people who are destroying property, Father. We want to pray that they have a change of heart and an increase of wisdom, Father. Touch their hearts, touch their minds, Father, to understand that we can accomplish nothing through destruction, Father. We can accomplish nothing through fighting, Father. We can only accomplish what we need to do through love and wisdom, Father, through your love, through your light, Father, through your message, Father, through your ways, Father. You are the blueprint, Father, to all things, Father. You are the blueprint, Father. And there's only two teams, Father. They're either on your team or they're on devil's team, Father. They're either on your team, they're your minion, they're your hands, your feet, your mouthpiece, or they are Satan's hands, Satan's mouthpiece, Satan's feet. So I pray that each and every person under the sound of my voice, everybody who witnesses this, this session, Father, has a change of heart, Father, and decide to have a change of heart to join your team, Father, to join your work, Father, to be a light in the world, Father, to understand that we are not here to be served. We are here to serve each other. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank y'all. Thank y'all. Amen. Thank y'all. Love y'all, man. Yeah, this song here is brand new by Jonathan Traylor. His brother's out of Dallas. He said, God will make you brand new. He will make you brand new, y'all. He saved my life, but he can save yours. Love y'all. Love y'all. Love y'all. Y'all have a great week.